from Tiger Stadium in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, the greatest place in the world to watch college football. It's the Tigers of LSU and the Gators of Florida. Hello, everyone. I'm Wayne Mack, and we're here tonight to tell you the story of this very important ball game in the SEC. Florida has won a game. This is the Tigers' first game in conference competition. On my left is Burt Jones, a man who certainly made his name here at LSU and in the pros for 10 years as an all-pro with Baltimore. On my right, Doug Morrill, one of the all-time greats here at LSU, and we don't use that term loosely. Let me serve as a devil's advocate here just a little bit, Burt. Let's say that you're Wayne Pease. You like that short passing game. You get rid of the ball quickly. What do you expect from the Tigers defensively?
Well, I would think the thing that the Tigers have to do, and I have to look at it from that side, is that they've got to get to Wayne. They've got to put a little pressure on him because he does take advantage of the short passing game. Consequently, the Tigers have to have a quicker rush, a little quicker stunts, not so much of the long blitzes, but the short blitzes, the inside linebackers, the things that can get in Wayne's face right at the beginning.
All right. Doug Morrill, I heard it rumored down in New Orleans that the Tigers had kept some of their offense under wraps. And now they were going to, tonight, reveal some plays and some action that they hadn't shown before.
You know, I heard somebody say that before last week's game, and they did unveil it. They used a lot of different formations. You know, LSU with a young quarterback is an unusual place. They ran a lot of formations, a lot of different plays last year with an experienced quarterback. And Jeff Wickersham had some of that experience as a backup, and he saw the system operate, and they held him back, it looked like, the first couple of weeks. Let him go a little bit last week, and I thought he performed marvelously, and I would expect that they'll give him as much freedom as he needs to put together a complete offense against this Florida defense.
All right, thank you very much. We'll be hearing from Doug and Burt tonight, but now let's go to the field and the LSU Tiger Band.
Please rise for the invocation.
All right, we'll be back in just a moment. All right, Chris Perkins ready to kick off for the Florida Gators. Jefferson and James are deep on the goal line for the Tigers. There's a kick. Jefferson, the freshman, takes it on the goal line, stumbles, moves, and he stopped just short of the 20. So the Tigers will put the ball in play after a 19-yard return by the freshman. And Jeff Wickersham goes out. You know, you wonder, here's a young man who hadn't seen much action, and he's completed 58% of his passes. Martin is an excellent target, of course, and Fontenot has become more important as you view the backfield with Hilliard and Gene Lang, the starters. Lang, a 202-pound fullback who does an excellent job, and of course, Hilliard has great Terpsichorean talent. Wickersham's going to throw on first down. It's a little screen setting it up, and Lang has it, but he's dropped for a loss. Well, that was Alonzo Johnson, number 93, in there for the tackle, and he broke that one up on us, Doug.
He made a great play. You see those down three right there have made an awful lot of tackles this year, but Alonzo Johnson there came up with a big play that time. LSU trying to open with a screen to the left. Johnson not fooled, and that tough secondary is going to be something for LSU to contend with.
The three down linemen for Florida have made 113 tackles this year. LSU's three down linemen have made 33. That's for comparison study. All right, here's motion by Hilliard. And up the middle, and that's not very much yardage, a couple of yards. It'll be Roy Harris, their most experienced defensive lineman, on the tackle. So we've got a third and about 11 now for the Tigers. And Fontenot comes in with a play from the coaches. A 34 defense for the Gators of Florida. Now we have two wideouts, Martin and Fontenot, and the backs are split for Jeff Wickersham from Merritt Island, Florida, the sophomore with a very strong arm. He wants to go deep, and he's got a man, and he overthrows. And the Tigers will have to punt the football. Well, do you think he did that just to test the secondary, let him know he can throw it, or what, Bert?
I think he did it for a reason. The main reason was not to throw something intermediate, give him an opportunity to get in that interception early. Just go ahead, come up fourth down, punt the ball, turn it over to the defense, say, well, we'll get a better shot the next time around.
All right, Clay Parker standing on his 4-yard line. Will take the snap from Gore and deliver the punt. A nice punt. Good one. Coming forward is Franklin Neal, and he lets the ball roll inside the 30. There it's down, and the Gators will take over. 55-yard punt for Clay Parker. Now you're going to see Wayne Peace. He's been a starter since early in his freshman campaign. Wayne Dixon is his leading receiver. Womas Brown is maybe the greatest tackle ever to play at Florida. Peace, Anderson, Henderson, and Lang round out the backfield. What a noise for Wayne Peace for his first call. Up to the 33. And that is Williams, who started. Sean Burks made the tackle. There was a possibility that Williams would start. He carried the ball four times last week for 104 yards. There's Kiddick, Barbe, and Osborne. Rydell Malasson, who's having a great campaign. Ricky Chapman also. And there's your secondary. Then a second and five. Williams carried four times last week for 104 yards. He's a single setback now. Peace has what he likes. Three men out to catch the football. And he's got a man. And it's B. Lang, a wide receiver who's knocked out by Dubrock after a 9-yard pickup and a first down. All right, what does that tell you, Bert?
Well, that tells me that Wayne Peace knows what he's doing out on the field. He had started out wanting to go to the left side of the field, didn't see anybody. Here you see him looking to his left, can't find anyone, comes back, throws it to the right. B. Johnson just comes up, gets enough for the first down.
All right. Early in the first quarter, no score in the ball game. This is the Gators' first possession. The Tigers had it. Three snaps and punt. Williams is a single setback. Peace carries it, and Doug Morrow, that looked like a broken play there, and it was Chapman who made the hit.
It looked like Peace expected to make the fake and then to have somebody after that to hand the ball off to or make the pitch, and he got confused after the initial move. He seemed stepping back, trying to go make a fake, and there was nobody there to do it to, so he just tucked it. He did the smart thing, and that's to keep the ball and keep possession. But a big play for LSU and Greg Dubrock.
Ricky Chapman from Winfield, Louisiana, having himself an excellent campaign. Second and 10 now for the Gators. High formation this time. Wide outs are left and right. Tigers cutting the line. Pitch back. No place to go. It's Neil Anderson. And a smothering Tiger defense stops him cold.
Wayne, it looks like Peace is at least taking a lot of time at the line of scrimmage. Whether he's checking plays off or not is hard to tell. But if he did that time, it looked like part of Florida's offensive line didn't pick it up because there really was nobody out there to lead interference on the tailback.
All right, you have to watch Dixon, his number one receiver. He's to the top of your screen. Williams is a single setback. He's drops. And it's caught, and it's Dixon, and he's inside the 30 and knocked down near the 25-yard line. Alex Clark made the hit, a 30-yard pickup. And Doug Morrow, how about that play?
Exceptional coverage, I think, by LSU, but Peace was given too much time to throw the ball, and Dixon, as big and strong as he is, went up. There you see Peace sitting back there waiting for Dixon to come open. LSU man-to-man coverage, and he's trying to get some help. Number 19, Alex Clark, was turned around, but Jeffrey Dale came over to help and wasn't able to get there in time.
That's Dixon's 97th career reception. He's passed Wes Chandler, for example, of Florida, who had 92. Williams straight ahead, off left guard in the shoulder of the center. Not a bad center either in the person of Phil Bromley. Eric Kiddick and Ricky Chapman made the tackle. Well, Bert Jones, the Tiger defense needs to tighten their chin straps here, it looks like.
Well, it really does. It looks as if they're trying and respect the run of Florida very much. They're lining up with a strong safety on the line of scrimmage. A great deal of time that you see Jeffrey Dale here. They're thinking run all the way.
Second and seven. Florida likes to run the football, but right now they're using the airways. And it's overthrown.
Dixon was the intended receiver. So it'll be third and seven. The ball on the 23-yard line of the Tigers with 10:30 to go in the first quarter of play and no score.
You see, Jerry Stovall, I think he's kind of worried that his group has given up so much yardage here in the first series. Florida stopped LSU absolutely cold and then took the punt. And after really a bad play by Florida, letting it roll dead, has taken the ball all the way deep into LSU's territory inside the 25. Third down, about eight to go.
Tigers are in a nickel defense now. Jefferson checks in and Kittick checks out. Big play, third and seven, early in the ball game. Lang in motion. Peace puts it out. Complete. Down short of the 15-yard line.
They see Wayne Peace taking advantage of the short passing game. Gets 8 yards, just enough for a first down. Neil Anderson comes up with the play.
That's pro-style passing. Jeffrey Dale on the tackle. Anderson made the grab. So it's first and 10 on the 15-yard line of the LSU Tigers. Tremendous crowd here in Baton Rouge tonight. We're happy to have this game once again on the USA Network. We had this one on USA Network last year. And we have the Alabama game on USA Network coming up. Bounces to the outside. Touchdown. All right, good speed and a good move by Neil Anderson that time, who just seemed to feel his way to the outside, and it seemed as if the Tigers didn't do anything to head him off.
Well, LSU really didn't do anything. Anderson came absolutely free. Here you see the handoff at ground level. He cut over his right tackle. Eric Kiddock got kicked out. And LSU, because the receivers were loaded on the other side of the formation, had their secondary over there. Anderson, 5'11", 197, and he moved that pretty quickly into the end zone for the touchdown.
Bobby Raymond will try the conversion. Florida has two punters and two kickers. And they're all four good. Criswell holds, the kick is up and good, and it's 7-0 with 9:53 to go here in the first quarter. The Gators of Florida 7, the Tigers of LSU nothing. We'll be back in a moment. All right, back to action. The Tigers of LSU with one possession, and they had to punt the football. The Gators took it for 9 plays, 72 yards, took them 3 minutes and 26 seconds, and Anderson took it in from 15 yards out. Do I get a feeling of lethargy, or is that the crowd that I'm reacting to, Doug Moran?
I get a feeling of surprise and shock by the LSU crowd. Florida just took it to them on the first drive. LSU needs to bounce back.
All right, ready for the kick. Gary James drifts into the end zone, 2 yards deep, and brings it out. And he's knocked down at the 10. And that is Ricky Nadiel. He is their headhunter on special teams and a backup defensive back, and he was down there and made a great play.
And this is the second time, Wayne, that LSU is starting deep in its own territory. A very bad place to start if you're a young quarterback coming out.
As you can see, both quarterbacks with excellent credentials this season. So Wickersham now trailing 7-0. Pitch back to James. And he cuts it running hard over the 20. Well, that's a 10-yard pickup, and that's a pretty good way to move. And Tony Lilly, a free safety and an All-SEC choice 2 years, made the hit.
And that's also a play, Wayne, LSU's got to be successful with in order to move the football at all. That's their basic play, just a pitch sweep, that time to the right side. And James got a good hole and just turned it upfield, put his head down for a big first down.
Junius Durrell and Eric Martin, the wideouts. Mitch Andrews, the tight end. And there goes James. Oh, this time he's caught from behind as he crosses the 20, just about back to the line of scrimmage. And it appeared that they caught him from the offside that time. Alonzo Johnson, a linebacker at number 93, chased him down. So the linebackers are very active. We haven't even heard from Wilbur Marshall yet, number 88. But he is an All-American candidate as the season started. He has a broken hand, however, which has impaired his play somewhat. But he still had 10 tackles last week. Second and 9. Wickersham hits Fontenot with the ball, and Fontenot breaks the tackle and gets over the 30. Good play by Herman Fontenot, a 10-yard pickup and another first down for the Tigers. And Randy Clark, who is considered an excellent defensive back for the Gators, drove him out.
That's is a good play by Fontenot because he was covered well, but he made the catch right before contact was made, held onto the ball, shrugged off the tackler, went ahead for the first down.
I like Wickersham looked the people off, too. He looked to the right and came back to the left of the pass. High formation. Looked to be like the Tigers were off. They were offside, I think. The flag was thrown. James carries, but the right side of the Tiger line jumped the gun, I believe, Bert.
Yes, it did. Looks like it's going to be first and 15. The referee called it, saw the right tackle jump a little bit before the snap of the ball, and that'll be tough for him.
Mark Korff made that hit. He's a junior college transfer who has been exceptionally talented, has shown a lot of good play for Florida this year, 6 feet, 224. LSU has been penalized 29 times, Florida 35 times for 317 yards. Now, that's a lot of penalties for four ball games. That could show a little lack of discipline or just some bad luck.
It may be a very aggressive team. They certainly do look aggressive today. You don't want them to make mistakes, even if they're aggressive, but it's very difficult to tell just by the numbers. This Florida team is the one that looks error-free so far. LSU with the penalty that sets them back. They really didn't gain much on first down. Wayne, I think one thing you may look for from a strategic standpoint, Florida's flowing to LSU's sweep very quickly. You may see LSU with some type of counteraction.
All right, now we have twin sets, both wide outs to the right, and James in motion to the right as Wickersham drops. He whistles a bullet in there, and Fontenot couldn't hang on, and that would have been a hard ball to catch.
Almost too hot to handle on that one, but it's better to throw it too hard than throw it too soft and let that defensive back take it the other way.
So we have a second and 15 now, 7-0. The Florida Gators leading the Tigers of LSU here in Baton Rouge in Tiger Stadium. 8 minutes and 12 seconds to go in the first quarter. Burt Jones and Doug Morrow offering their expertise and analysis. Here's truly Wayne Mack with the story of the ball game. Durrell to the top of your screen now and Martin to the bottom. Strong right this time with Mitch Andrews at tight end. Jeff Wickersham, fine sophomore. Dropped way back this time. He's got Martin, but he couldn't hit him. Defending over there was Bruce Vaughn. So we have a third and 15 coming up. Bert, how'd you look at that play?
I looked at that as a pretty good pass, but it showed a little bit of inexperience on Jeff's part there, because that's the kind of pass, when he gets a little more time under his belt, he'll put a little air under that ball, as they say, put it up in the air so it gets over that defensive back. It's not on the line, and it gives his receiver a little better opportunity to catch the ball.
8:05 to go in the first quarter. The Gators of Florida, 7. The Tigers of LSU, nothing. Motion now. Wilbur Marshall moves, and he's going to blitz. Here he comes. They pick him up, but he hits Wickersham as Wickersham throws the ball. Well, you can see that one developing as Wilbur Marshall moved from an inside spot to the outside and shot the gap, and the Tigers picked him up, but not enough.
You're going to see Wilbur Marshall went from his right defensive side over to the left side right at the beginning of the play, and he just ran around a man trying to block him, got to Wickersham. Fortunately, Wickersham got the ball off before the sack.
Lang was attempting to block on the play, but Marshall just blew right on past. He had a good head of steam up. There's a snap to Parker, and the punt. Franklin Neal gathers it in, and a flag is down as he's knocked out of bounds. 38-yard punt and a 5-yard return. So Wayne Pease, with a 7-0 margin, has good field position here to begin his second series for the Gators. And the offense trots on the field. And, well, there are very imposing statistics as far as Florida is concerned. Charlie Pell likes to establish that running game, and when he's successful with a running game, he most always wins.
Well, they've got a tremendous record when they've outgained people in the rush. And here you see he's going to have a chance to gain 15 more yards on this drive if he is successful with the rush, because he added to his penalty total we were talking about a moment ago. 15 yards for clipping on the punt return. And when a flag is thrown in that area, that's usually the only thing it can be. But that puts Florida back inside their own 25. It may give LSU a little advantage defensively to try a few things to slow up Florida's defense.
All right, see if they can upset Pease's rhythm, but he's tough. Led the nation in pass percentage last year, 68%. Up to the 29, a flag again as Williams carries the ball. Greg Dubrock made the hit. 238-pound, 6'3", junior. One of the tandem of outside backers will do a great job for the Tigers. And the Gators are going to march backward again. Well, it just appears to me that the Tigers don't seem to be leaping off the ball on defense.
Well, I think they'd like to leap off the ball, but we talked before the game, it's difficult to put two games back-to-back with the enthusiasm they had last week. On top of that, they're playing a better football team than they played last week. Here you see it's a holding call, so that's another 15 yards, or at least...
All right, now we mentioned that...
That's 5 yards.
We mentioned that Florida has been penalized 317 yards coming into this ball game, and there are two quick ones right there that gives an indication that they do have problems with penalties. Now we have a first and 18. Williams is a lone setback, and there are three wide receivers for Pease, and he gives the ball to Williams. Once again, he tries to turn the corner, but he's caught and knocked out of bounds by Dubrock and Sean Burks. A couple of linebackers teaming up for the hit. Well, they do seem also to be testing the outside, going off tackle and trying to turn the corner on the Tigers.
Well, pretty much LSU's defense has been subject to perimeter running, that being on the outside, that being right inside their force man. And Florida's seen it in the film, and they're trying to take advantage of it.
They saw what Florida State did. All right, second and 12 now. Once again, Williams is a lone setback, and there are three wideouts, and the crowd is on LSU's side, as you can hear. Williams gets the call again, and he's knocked down by Chapman. Ricky Chapman cut in behind the pulling guard on the play and really made a great play.
That's just a fabulous play by Chapman. Florida's lining up an awful lot, Wayne, in double wing, and they're forcing LSU to go into man-to-man coverage in the secondary, trying to get those people away. And here you see against that defense a quick pitch, and Chapman just went right over his blocker, made the tackle in the backfield. Tremendous play by Ricky Chapman, who's really come on in the last 2 weeks.
Third and 12 now, and the nickel defense for the Tigers. Three wideouts. Single setback. And it's to Lorenzo Hampton, a running back, who lined up wide, and he's knocked down by Jeffrey Dale at the 32-yard line. Lorenzo Hampton, who was a starter last year, and this year as a backup, they pick up 11 yards, so now they're fourth and about a yard to go, and that was a close call. But they haven't not sent the punting team on yet. Fourth and one. Now there they come.
Well, you remember Charlie Pell last year, early in the ball game, having a fourth and one situation at around midfield, chose to go for it. LSU stopped him and went in and drove for a touchdown. And I think you probably remember that in making that decision.
All right, fourth and one. The punt by Bobby Raymond. Jefferson takes it on the 24. Oh, he's giving ground and he's being chased. Hey, Mom, help. Is that a freshman mistake?
I don't think there's any question about it. He lost 10 yards on the punt return. It's one of those things that you'll learn that you never do. Never reverse your field when catching a punt. It was a low line drive type punt, one that he felt like he probably could have come up with a good reception here or a good return. But here you see him looking for his blockers. Doesn't see him, says, I think I'll turn around and go try it this way. But that's the one mistake you can't do.
So a 43-yard punt becomes a 53-yard punt. First down for the Tigers on the 15. Wickersham looks to his right. And it's good for about five. Over to Herman Fontenot.
That kind of pass shows a lot of confidence in the arm of a quarterback. He's thrown to the wide side of the field. In college ball, you can almost throw the ball 50 yards to get a five-yard game, as he did there.
Ricky Eastman, 5'10", 155-pound cornerback. Put the hit on him. That's not very much meat and potatoes, 155 pounds. All right, Wickersham. This time good for a couple. Well, Hilliard is in the ball game. James doing most of the work thus far. Fred McAllister, another good linebacker, a senior, 234 pounds on a 6-foot frame, and he made the hit.
It's pretty tough running inside there, isn't it? You know why those three guys have 130-some-odd tackles among them?
That's right. They are very busy. They have a real 32, those two linebackers plugging the gap behind those three down linemen. Here's Hilliard in the game. He's caught from behind. Well, the defense seems to be coming in the back door on the running game.
It really does. That
pitch sweep that LSU does so frequently, and especially this time, is just strength against strength, saying, we're coming to the wide side of the field. We're coming outside. You just have to stop us, and that time Florida did.
Well, Jim Newton did it. He's 6 feet, 270 pounds. Frankie Neal, number 21, is back to take the punt from Parker, his third punt already, and we have 4 minutes plus to go in the first quarter. So that gives you an indication of how the Tiger offense has been stymied. High! It may never come down. Neal calls for the fair catch on the 29. A 48-yard punt, a beauty, and no return. Well, the Tiger defense needs to make a big play here, it seems, if they want to sort of inspire the offense, because the offense has not been able to move the football on a very, of course, they knew this Florida defense was tough, didn't they?
Sure did. And fortunately, Clay Parker's kicking the ball well. You know, last week against Washington, Washington had a punter that averaged about 30 yards, but Ray Criswell from Florida is right around 48 yards, and he's really putting LSU back in a hole, so Parker's just got to kick well to keep LSU back out of their own end of the field.
First down on the 29. Wayne Pease, very talented quarterback. This time he makes no bones about it. He whips it out toward Dixon, but he overthrows him. Dixon is a good target, a fine receiver. Jerry Stovall pacing the sideline saying, come on, gents, let's do something here.
You know, Jerry Stovall was an all-pro up in St. Louis a number of years, and I think he relates directly to those defensive backs. And when he sees the cornerback laying off like Clark was on that one, he's going to say, come on, play him tougher, play him tighter. Don't give him that cushion. Let's see if he listens.
All right. Second and 10 now. Single set back again. Tigers are showing the blitz, but they don't. Besides, that offensive line picked them up, and Hampton that time scooped it off the turf, it appeared. They're going to give him a completion. Well, maybe so.
Well, it kind of looked like he scooped it off. He did make a nice catch. Here we see it from ground level. We'll be able to tell it. I believe he's coming out. LSU, again, running against a double-wing offense. And let's give him the catch. Let's give him the catch. A nice catch. Florida got LSU on man-to-man coverage, and the Tigers had a mix-up in the secondary.
Pease is 5 for 7 for 64 yards. Motion by Lang. Pease looks to the left. It's Hampton with the ball, and he's knocked down at the 38-yard line by Alex Clark. Well, this year they're using Hampton as a wide receiver, and what do we have here? Did they recover the loose ball? No, they have to punt.
That was just a poor play on his part. He should have gotten a first down on that one.
Criswell, number 13, a sophomore, gets it off. Fair catch being called for at the 25 by Jefferson. 37-yard punt. That's a short one for Criswell. His longest of the year is 59. His average is 48. How's that for consistency? That may be the shortest punt he's delivered this year. They have a talented kicking unit. Perkins has hit field goals of 48 and 53. The longest punt return by Florida this year is only 7 yards going into this ballgame. By Neal. All right. What do the Tigers do? They have a first down on the 25 this time. Not much. Now, what are they doing here? Just trying to establish that running game, trying to get the assert a little authority on that line of scrimmage? Doug?
I think that, well, Doug, what do you think? I think that what they're trying to do is just try to establish a little run, a little pass, but get something positive going. What do you think, Doug?
I think they're having a hard time finding something to work. They've tried a lot of different things, and Florida's gotten a good pass rush when they've tried to throw. They've covered the receivers well, and they've stopped them dead in their tracks on the run. So I think they're trying to find something that'll work in their package.
All right, second and 6. We have 3 wideouts in the ball game. Wickersham looks over here to Junius Doral, and he caught it, and then he was caught. I mean, he was knocked down quickly by Bruce Vaughn that time.
Bert, like you said, though, that's an awful long way to throw the ball, to pick up about 2 yards, and a very dangerous pass to throw it out to the sideline like that.
It really is. It shows a lot of confidence in Jeff Wickersham's arm there, because he's throwing that ball all the way across the field, and there's nothing wrong with that if you have a gifted player like Jeff Wickersham.
Fontenot brings in the play and breaks off to the right. Martin to the bottom of your screen. Wickersham is 4 of 8 for 12 yards. Third and 3. 7-0 Gators. Lang gets the call and gets to about the 33. And they'll have to punt it away again. Well, not much there. 3 rolls and no coffee. And Parker comes on for his 4th punt of the first quarter. We have a minute and 12 to go.
I wonder what he's going to do when it gets cold with that bare foot.
I don't know, but we have Neal going back. Frankie Neal awaiting the punt. And Parker right now is a very important weapon for LSU. And this time it's a line drive. It's going to bounce. And Neal has to let it roll. He walks away from it, and that's a good break for the Tigers. As Neal did the right thing there, didn't he?
He did. There really nothing he could do, because the ball was punted very, very short. Parker, though, got it to spiral, and it landed with the tail landing closest to Parker. So the ball kicked away from him downfield, and Neal really couldn't find a good spot to catch the ball. So rather than try to fumble it with LSU on top of him, he just ran out of the way. Fortunately, a big break for LSU. 52 yards by Parker, and Florida back on their 15.
All right, Neal took off like Mama called him home for supper. Now we have V. Lang split to the top of your screen. Dixon to the bottom. The fans want some spark here from the defense. And the Gators respond with a crack up the middle that's very effective up to the 24-yard line. 9-yard pickup by Hampton. Lorenzo Hampton, who was a starter last year. Liffert Hobley made the hit. Have a couple of very good free safeties in this ball game, gentlemen, no doubt about that. In Hobley and Lilly.
They really are. They make tackles all across the football field, and they also defend against the pass very well.
2nd and 1. Wayne Peace. And they probably picked up the yard. These two ball clubs have sent an awful lot of players into the pro ranks, no doubt about that.
I think she's going to have to say hi, Grandma, isn't she?
Wayne Peace looks like he's headed for the pros, too, as a high draft choice. A lot of players from LSU in the NFL and the USFL. And same with the Gators of Florida.
1st and 10. Winding down here to the final second of the first quarter. And that's it. So we'll take a break here in Tiger Stadium in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, where the LSU offense has been stymied and the defense has been tested. The Gators lead by a score of 7-0. We'll be back in a moment. All right, back to action here with the Florida Gators leading LSU. This is one of those games where the Tigers may be a little flat after that great emotional experience last week, but as this game wears on, they can sort of pick up a spark.
They're really going to have to, because playing as long as I did, the one thing you have to have is a consistency level. That means you have to be consistently good week in and week out if you want to be a top-ranked team.
All right, 1st and 10, Wayne Peace. And now Odom, the tight end, moves over to the left side. Hampton gets the call, gets the ball, and gets knocked down. And
that's pretty good play by Freddie Lewis there. He came in the backfield and tackled Hampton before he was able to get up ahead of steam, because he had an awful lot of interference ahead of him. But one thing you saw on that play was that Lewis was there. He hit Hampton. Hampton spun away and fell to the ground. He was not supported by any other pursuit. And LSU's got to get pursuit in there to stop that ball carrier.
Lewis is in, giving Rydell Melanson a rest. 2nd and 9. Now Odom takes up position on the right. High formation for Wayne Peace. Little jump pass, and it's caught by Williams, and Chatman runs him out of bounds before he can get to the 35-yard line. How do you like that play, Burt Jones?
That was a real good play on Wayne Peace's part, because had he held on the ball a little bit longer, he would have been sacked for a loss. But
In retrospect, what he did is just got rid of the football, gave him 6 or 7 yards, and a fine play.
Doug, why do we see a tight end take up his position so late in a play? Is he trying to confuse the defense?
Yeah, LSU switches their safeties and their linebackers, and when the tight end switches from one side to the other, that time Jeff Riddell got caught on the backside of the formation.
All right, third and two. B. Lang in motion. Big pitch to Hampton. And he breaks a tackle and gets away from Clark, and Lifford Hobley brings him down after a 6-yard pickup.
Do you remember who ran the option successfully about 3 games ago, though?
Yep.
You think they didn't see that film? Florida State executed very well. Here you see Peace. He's going to run the option coming to the left. It's kind of a counter option, and he really didn't have any intention of keeping it, but he occupied Freddie Lewis and then made the pitch to Hampton, who was able to get outside. A big first down, and just another play that Florida added to their offense for this big game.
They saw that Florida State working the option, and they're emulating that success right now. Peace in place of Lowry. Oh, there's a quick pitch out for a quick screen with no screen. He gets up to the 50, as it was Dixon again, and it was Clark making the hit, and once again a 9-yard pickup, and you couldn't ask for better yardage, and they're getting on first down.
You really can't. The key to having success offensively is to get a good first down play. As you saw there, once again, they're taking advantage of the LSU corners, playing 8 and 9 yards off, giving them a soft cushion. Alex Clark was back, threw the ball in a standstill position, and picked up 9 yards.
All right, now we have a tight end now. Odom, once again, moving to a strong left. And that's Neil Anderson carrying the ball. Just needed a yard.
And he got it.
Here comes Malosov back in the ball game, and Lewis checks out. Eric Kittick made the stop, but they got the first yard. Last week at Mississippi State, Florida converted on 13 of 20 third down conversions. Now, when a team has 20 third down conversions, that means they're grinding it out, doesn't it?
It really does. They're doing a good job when they get it.
They were good of 9 of 11 in the second half, so they were stronger as the game moved on. Tigers show the blitz and back out. Peace drops. Plenty of time. Throws it away. The fans want intentional grounding. He says, no, no, I was throwing to that fellow over there.
There's where the experience comes in. There was nobody in the picture over there, but he knew if he threw it far enough downfield that the referee standing behind him wasn't going to call it.
You know what I see Peace doing right now? I think that is Lang, who didn't hurry getting back to the huddle. And Peace motioned for him to get back here in this huddle, and let's get going. A quarterback likes those wideouts to get back in that huddle in a hurry, don't you, Bert?
You bet.
Those quarterbacks also cover for each other on the intentional grounding, don't they?
Dixon to the top of your screen and Lang to the bottom. Second and 10, 7-0 Florida. Second quarter, pitch. Lorenzo Hampton knocked down behind the line. Very good play. Got Ricky Chapman cracking through, and he had some help.
And that's the kind of play LSU needs to get from the linebacker on the front side of that sweep. That time, Rydell Malosov just stood up the tight end, skated outside with him. He forced the ball carrier inside and let the pursuit. Kiddock and Chapman come over and make that tackle.
Hampton has 17 yards and 4 carries. Williams has 15 and 4 carries. Third and 9. They're good on third down conversions. And Hampton loses the ball and goes down with it. And they'll have to punt this time back from their own 47. Did Hampton do the right thing there and going down with the ball or not?
I don't think he had any choice. I think he was just trying to hang on to that football. I thought it was a very unusual call by Florida with one of the most gifted passers in the SEC. Here you see it's a little high, a little behind him, and he goes, where'd it go? Up there it is right there, and he just fell down with it.
Now Nardone is in the punt, and he's a finesse punter. He's good for the coffin corner, and that's what he's trying to do right now. And it goes out of bounds at about the 19-yard line where the Tigers will put the ball in play. A 33-yard punt, and that was his intent to get it inside the 20, but I'm sure he wanted to get it a little farther than that. Now the crowd cheers as the Tigers take the field. With 11:15 to go in the second quarter, first down on the 19-yard line, with the Gators leading 7-0. And since that first scoring drive by Florida, it's been a sort of a seesaw without much production. especially from LSU. Lang is a fullback. Fontenot in motion. And I don't know what happened to this one, but Wickersham's running. And he's brought down. What happened there, gentlemen? Was that a busted play or what?
Well, being a quarterback and having this happen to me a few times along the line, you see Jeff Wickersham, he just mishandled the snap of the ball. He made a good play picking it up off the ground without going down with it, coming up, trying to make the handoff, realizing that he doesn't have a good chance to get the handoff cleanly. So he just holds on to it and says, well, I think I'll chew on this end this time.
Only got 5 yards.
See, ought to chew on that end some more. That's the best running game they've had quite a while.
That's a pretty good game for the Tigers thus far. Lang now is a single setback as Hilliard goes in motion. He says, oh, I think I'll go back. And Hilliard gets a call with an inside reverse, dropped the ball and fell on it. Well, the Tiger special is hitting on about three cylinders.
There's a lady who's seen some LSU wins, some LSU losses, and has not seen any LSU points tonight, though. I'm sure she'd like to.
She looks like she's having a ball. Well, what happened there, gentlemen? That was a tough play to run, wasn't it, against a tough inside defense?
Wilbur Marshall got good penetration that time, and he really shut down LSU. It was a little inside reverse, but LSU couldn't get any good ball handling.
Third and five now. Wickersham's going to put it up. He's got some time, and he's got a man open. It's Fitch Andrews, a tight end. Just his sixth catch of the year, and it's for 17 yards, Doug Morrow.
Well, that's the guy, Wayne, that LSU's got to use some. Here Andrews takes an inside release. Now he's going to be hooking up in the middle of the field. Florida's got everybody covered all around him, and they have three people around him. But Wickersham throws the ball just in the right spot, and Andrews makes a great catch for the first down.
First and 10, 10:30 to go in the second quarter. The Gators lead 7-0. The Tigers may have something cooking. We'll see if Hilliard can turn the corner. Lang throws a block. He cuts behind it, but boy, the Gators jammed it up.
They did, but they still almost made 5 yards on that, and that is a good first down play. But there you see, LSU saying, we're going to throw this tall sweep at you a few times in this game. I don't care if all your men line up over there. We're going to run it. We've been successful, and we were that time. We gained 5 yards.
Randy Clark, an excellent all-around defensive back, made the tackle. He's a Husky, went 6 feet, 198, a senior, second and five. Fontenot in motion. Once again, Hilliard follows a block by Lang, but the Gators really string that one out. And I see Mark Korff, a junior college transfer, leading the defensive charge. Why can't they get outside? What's happening that they're running into heavy traffic?
Well, here you'll see right here, actually wasn't an outside design play. It was just trying to get off the corner somewhere. He breaks it to the outside, and there are four men on the outside. He says, we're not letting you get outside. You're too fast to do that.
And it was Wilbur Marshall who had the outside lane stop. 5 carries for 8 yards for Hilliard. Wickersham to throw. Uh-oh. Incomplete. So the punting team comes on again as this number five.
Although he didn't make the tackle that time, Wilbur Marshall again put pressure on the quarterback. Wickersham had to kind of step out of the pocket and then run throwing to his left, which is very difficult to do. But LSU has thus far not done anything to effectively neutralize Marshall. They run to him sometimes. He makes a tackle. They run away. He catches it from behind.
Neal is on the 15. Clay Parker is on his 30. Well, another punt that's difficult to handle. Artistically, it wasn't too good, but it got inside the 20-yard line, 36 yards, with no return. You think she cares who wins tonight?
I'm not sure.
First and 10 now for Wayne Peace. Now, here's a situation where the Gators are on the 18-yard line. Burt Jones, they have 8:56 to go. Do you think they might let the air out of it here and try and do something?
Well, they've had pretty good success running the ball, except on third and nine when they tried it the last time. But I think I would let Wayne Peace throw the ball if it were me.
He has three wide receivers now and a single setback, so he may be looking to do that, and he is. And he's trying to set up a screen to Williams, and he overthrows him, and that one never would have worked. He had a guard over there, but there were three Tigers between Williams and the guard who pulled the block on the play.
Yeah, we're on that. And one of the toughest times to throw a screen play is when you have a man-to-man coverage, because there's a defensive back or a linebacker covering every man that's eligible for a pass. And one of those is a screen man. So there's always somebody just following him around saying, hey, you're my man to cover this time.
He's his 8 of 12, 83 yards. Sean Burks, inside linebacker, looks over to the defensive coaches and gets the call. Tigers have not tried the blitz much tonight, if at all. Second and 10. Pitch back. Anderson turns the corner. Stepped out of bounds. Once again, Neil Anderson got around the corner. Hobley stopped him, but he picked up 9.
And Wayne, that's not bad play from the LSU defense, except they're not getting there in time. You know, you talk about people getting outside and around you. Here you're going to see the right side of LSU's defense, 99 Rydell Malosso on the bottom part of your picture. And he did a fairly decent job of fighting off the blockers, but Anderson is so fast, he got outside of Malosso as fast as Malosso has. And so that gives you a little idea of how difficult it's going to be to stop that sweep. Florida's got the same type of speed at tailback that Florida State did, and it's difficult for LSU to stop them.
Third and 1, Lang in motion, 7-0 Florida. Hey, they might have stopped him. That was Joe Henderson, the fullback. And he was hit and driven back. Let's see where they marked the ball, and it will have the chain gang come in. Good defensive job there by the Tigers. Even if they got it, it was a good job. But here come the chain gang, and we'll see. The Tigers need a defensive play. 8:46 to go in the second quarter. Florida has been tough. They lead 7-0. And they got it by half the length of the ball, or three quarters.
Here you see it coming outside. Rydell Malosso just comes in, makes a good play, but he edges in there just enough to make the first.
So the ball is on the 29, and the Gators get to keep it. Dixon to the top, Lang to the bottom. Peace, calm and cool down there. He's a pro. All right, a quick screen set up. And fortunately, he fell down. That is Ricky Natale, a wide receiver, who's also a real good ball player on special teams.
Well, that was an unusual quick screen to the outside receiver. On that one, they just said, cornerback, we're going to let our receiver try to outrun you or out fake you, and they're going to turn the tackle on the inside pursuit. And he almost did it.
First and 10 on the 41. Florida with a 7-0 lead. Second quarter action. Straight ahead. Good gang tackling by the Tigers that time.
Well, it looks like LSU's defense is settling into the game a little bit on this drive. However, Florida is still making the big plays when they need it. Earlier in the game, Florida was ripping off the big yardage on first down. Here, LSU stopped them on the first down, but at least one out of three downs, they're picking up 11 or 12 yards, and the Tigers will never stop them with that type of inconsistency on defense.
All right, we have a nickel defense in there now for the Tigers. On second and 9, they're looking for a pass, and it's incomplete. That time they shot the gap, and Joe Henderson had no chance to pick that one up. Well, can you upset the rhythm of a real top-notch quarterback?
You bet you can. When you have someone like Rydell Malosso standing right in front of you, in your face, saying, you better hurry up or I'm going to get you. You can see, even an experienced player from Florida had to get rid of it a little too early.
Third and 9. Last time they had this, third and long, they ran the football. Uh-oh. Tigers jump back. Peace drops, and Lorenzo Hampton is wide open, heading down the sideline. Chapman chases. Touchdown. Oh, brother. I don't think the Tigers will enjoy looking at the film of that one. 58 yards.
Wayne, you see a situation which LSU just blew the pass coverage.
Peace came up to the line of scrimmage. It was 9 yards to go. LSU lined up in the blitz. Here you see Jeffrey Dale, the safety, is in the backfield, and that's his man down the middle of the field, Hampton. LSU only had two people back there. They had no other defensive backs, and Florida had four quick receivers down the field. Just a very, very serious defensive mistake by LSU, and Florida took advantage. It cost the touchdown.
So it's 13-0 now with 7:25 to go in the second quarter. The kick is good by Bobby Raymond. It's 14-0.
I think they've studied the films well, saw the blitz coming, and called the play just what they wanted to do.
Perkins kicks. And the official says it went out of bounds, I believe. If it did, why, in the field of play, they'll have to kick it over. But I didn't see a flag.
So they're bringing it back. He's pretending that he threw the flag anyway.
He dropped it right behind the pylon over there on the other side.
Yeah. In the shadow,
I didn't see him throw it down. I saw him pick it up.
Oh.
Either he put it there before the game or he threw it just now.
All right, so they'll have to kick off again with a 5-yard penalty.
Maybe he was expecting that.
Yeah, maybe so.
You know, I'll tell you how impressive that 14-0 score is. Remember how many times Florida had the ball inside of their 20 in that first quarter and a half, and they've taken it and really rammed it down LSU's throat the first time they had it for the touchdown, and that time called the right play against the right defense, and a great bit of running by Hampton after the reception.
Well, LSU has punted 13 times total coming into this ball game, and they punted 5 times already in this one. That shows how the offense has been stopped. So now the kickoff from the 35. Not too deep. James lets it bounce, picks it up on the 10, and is knocked down before he can reach the 20. Why do you think he let that one bounce?
I think he just misjudged the ball. I certainly don't think he wanted to let it bounce on that time, but he just said, oops, a little bit shorter than what I thought it was, and it hit the ground.
All right, Jeff Wickersham, the sophomore with a strong arm, comes on the field now to see if he can get something going here for the Tigers. First and 10 on the 20. Rathjen is in at fullback. And James the tailback. And that pass intended for Andrews again is knocked down by Wilbur Marshall.
Wilbur Marshall is an extremely fast linebacker, showing here. He's fast on his rush. There you saw him covering the back man for man in coverage. He did a fine job. He's a tremendous outside linebacker. He'll be a good pro.
6'1", 237, good size, and he's playing with a broken hand, which has impaired his play. But thus far tonight, it hasn't seemed to slow him down a bit. Second and 10 for the Tigers. James is in with Rathjen, and Jeff Wickersham drops. James has the ball, breaks the tackle. And that's patented James running, good for 13 yards, and Mark Korf brings him down.
Wayne, that's the type of thing LSU's just got to do, is to get the ball to those running backs in the open field. Here you see a little pass over the middle to James, who's just coming across behind the receivers and cleared it out, made the catch, and then picked up the extra yardage for the first down. But the key to LSU's offense is to get the ball in the hands of Hilliard and James in that open field where they can have some one-on-one situations.
All right, first and 10, 6:54 to go in the second quarter, 14-0 Florida. Wickersham's going to throw again. This time he wants a bunch.
What a catch! What a throw! What a play! Oh, I tell you, was that a magnificent catch, 52 yards to Eric Martin. And it's tough for anyone to believe how hard that catch is to make. The ball was thrown over beyond Florida's secondary. Martin was running, looking almost directly over his head, and reached out and with the softest hands you can imagine, made a fabulous catch, continued before him, tripped and was tackled, a combination down to the 15. Great pass and a great reception ball.
Tony Lilly, I think, got a hand on him. A 52-yard pickup. Wickersham is 7 of 13 for 94 yards now with 6:42 to go. And that is the number one offensive thrust for the the Tigers tonight. And Bert Jones, I saw a sparkle in your eye on that one. Don't you love a receiver like that?
He did a fine job catching that ball. Actually, he looked as if to me he might have even been interfered with. He looked like he was slowed up, and then he caught it just with the tips of his fingers. I bet he didn't cut his fingernails today, because had he wouldn't have made that play.
That is Martin's 14th catch of the season. He's averaging 21 and a half yards a grab. He has the Tigers' only touchdown by the pass route. What an athlete. Started out as a tailback, huh? Last year caught 45 passes. This year he has a really good campaign going. The Tigers have the ball on the 15-yard line of the Gators. Florida leading 14 to nothing. A well-disciplined, tough Florida team leading the Tigers here in Baton Rouge. What do you look for here, Doug?
I look for LSU to do anything here. They've got a little bit of momentum, and I would expect for him to go ahead back to maybe a short pass. Here's the sweep coming.
Grafton and James. James gets the call. Once again, great pursuit as it's Alonzo Johnson, a very busy linebacker, who penetrates well. Is somebody not picking him up, or is he just really good at keeping away from the cops?
I tell you, let me mention why I just said that. LSU, I think, had a pass called. LSU four times. Wickersham has come to the line of scrimmage and is checking off. He's raising his hand and signaling the outside receiver, apparently off of a pass pattern, to let him know a running play is coming his side. Four times he's done that. Four times LSU's run the sweep through that side.
Second and eight. James, reverse to Durrell, but they smell it out. Brother, it's Ricky Eastman, a five-yard loss. And the Gators have an experienced defense, gentlemen.
It looked as if they were almost playing the play all the way. Here you see, they've got two tight ends in. Had it not been for a good block by Jeff Wickersham, they probably would have lost 10 yards on that one. But Durrell comes around, gifted runner, but there's just no place to go today.
Tigers call a timeout here, so with 5:34 to go in the first half, the Gators leading 14 to nothing, a third and 12 for LSU. We take timeout, and we'll be back in a moment. All right, any coach has a third and 12 play in his bag. There's no doubt about that with 5:34 to go and you're down 14 to nothing.
Yeah, but not all of them work, and I know LSU is hoping this one will.
The backs are split this time. James and Rastin. James picks up the linebacker. And wide open, Martin.
Excellent play by Wickersham there. They had the blitz, strong safety blitz. They picked it up in the backfield. And he just picked it up. Here you see, going back. There comes the strong safety on the weak side. Gary James picks it up, and Jeff Wickersham does a perfect job hitting Eric Martin right in the end zone. Touchdown, Mama.
Boy, that's when you have the right play called and executed very well. LSU ran a slot formation with a halfback strong to that side, and Florida blitzed on that side. The Tigers ended up with man coverage on Eric Martin. He ran a good corner pattern, wide open in the end zone.
Gore centers, Mackey holds. The console kicks and it's good with 5:27 to go in the half now. Florida 14, LSU 7. We'll be back in a moment. Eric Martin, the man of the hour. It's 14 to 7. How did he get that wide open? I saw Gary James did a great job picking up a blitz.
He sure did. Eric Martin just made a good move on the defensive back. Comes out to be touchdown. Six plays, 80 yards, a minute 58 seconds. Doesn't take very long when you put it in the air.
They moved 80 yards, and Martin accounted for 69 in two plays. Lorenzo Hampton is deep, but he's the blocking man, as it's taken instead by number 25, Roger Sibbald. 26-yard pickup. First they had Hampton back there by himself, and they moved Sibbald back. All right, now the Tigers of LSU should feel a little defensive spark after that offensive thrust. And the Gators might feel inspired here. This is a good football game. These guys are tough. Two really good football players. 5:21 to go in the half. Barbez on the center. Bromley's nose. Peace throws. Well, there's one of those quick look-ins, huh?
Yeah, that's what Wayne Peace does the best. He throws these quick slants, quick outs, quick hitting passes to his receivers, and they're tough to defend. Look at Dan Fouts and all the success he's had with him in San Diego, and this is just kind of like a mirror play.
Dubrock with the tackle. 7-yard pickup, second and three. 4:50 to go. Peace is 11 of 16, 159 yards and a touch. And that, a 58-yard play, and he beat the blitz. Well, they're running the ball well, as Charlie Pell likes to run it well. And they get the first down.
Florida's getting such good blocking up front. When they get the ball to Anderson or Hampton deep in the backfield and they get any kind of lead blocking, they're so quick that they can get right through the hole and get in the LSU secondary and pick up that yardage very quickly.
And they have Lomas Brown, a 6'4", 277-pound tackle that they feel may be, before he quits, the best ever at Florida. Straight ahead to the midfield stripe. Joe Henderson. Just a quick hitter that time, and Pritchie made the tackle. Picked up a couple, second and eight. 4 minutes remaining. Time is important, but Florida has plenty. Each team with two timeouts remaining. The ball is on the LSU side of the 50. Now we have Petty, the second tight end in the ball game. He's whipped one out here. Oh! That was Williams made the catch, and it was Clark made the hit. Lost about a yard on that one.
That was a good tackle by Alex Clark, showing that he can tackle in open field one-on-one. Here you see, it's just a rotated zone. He's on the outside playing the cornerback, has a short zone, and they threw it in my zone. He says, I've got to make the play here, and does.
Hampton comes into the play. Dixon, he's a big possession man. He's to the top of your screen. B. Lang at the bottom, and now Hampton is a third wide receiver in a slot to the right with a single setback. And that's Williams, and he picks up a blitzing Lewis, the linebacker, and Peace gets off the pass to Dixon on a slant, and that was just about like you draw it up on the board.
And he was wide open in the middle. LSU with five defensive backs on that play. And Florida cleared out that side and then brought their wide receiver in kind of on the quick post. Here you see Peace angling to the right, and he's checking his receiver going out in the flat, who was open temporarily, and then he came back to the inside and hit Dixon, who was open on the curl. LSU secondary man Clark had fallen down behind him.
And they were doing a good job double-teaming Randy Barbee that time, keeping him out. 2:35 to go now. First down for Florida after an 18-yard pickup. Another quick slant, and this one's to Ray McDonald. Well, that's a tough play to defense, 10 yards.
And how he got it in there, I don't know, because he had double coverage on him, a man jamming him at the line of scrimmage, but he still gets it. Here you see Wayne Peace dropping back. Little quick hitter, three-step drops, and here it comes.
I'll tell you, it just appears to me that their offensive line is doing a good job giving Peace that extra couple of seconds that he needs for those patterns to develop. See what the chain gang has to say about all this. 2:15 to go, first half. First down. All right. Florida in the huddle. Wayne Peace. He's calling the plays, calling the shots, and doing an excellent job. First and 10. Strong left this time. Whoop! Looks like they had a little movement in the line. And that time, Anderson is caught by Eric Kittick before the play can develop. Here comes Jefferson now, and checking out is Kittick.
That's just good pursuit by the backside of LSU's defense. Again, Florida with a second and long situation in the last 5 or 6 minutes. They've had three or four of these, and they've made first downs every time.
Minute and 25 to go in the half. Second and 9 on the 21-yard line of the Tigers. Peace. Overthrows Dixon. It'll be 3rd and 9. Peace is 14 of 20 for 185 yards. Williams is 4 carries, 15 yards. Anderson, 7 carries, 27 yards. Hampton, 4 carries, 17 yards. Third and 9, minute and 13. Lying in motion. They try to run it. And it's Ricky Chapman who cracked through to break up the rhythm in the play.
And once again, Wayne, they ran it on 3rd and 9 with the gifted passer that they have. They must just think they can fool the LSU defense. Here you see it. Just nothing fancy. Just a little counter right up the middle. And what do they get? -4 or 5 yards.
You have an accurate passer in Peace. We have a 40-yard field goal attempt probably coming up. Bobby Raymond has been assigned the kicking job. It's either Perkins or Raymond. They have two. It's 4th and 11 on the 23. 50 seconds to go. Why do you think they run the ball when they have such an accurate passer and an excellent short passing game, Bert?
Well, they must have seen something earlier in the week in the film that dictated to them that on 3rd and 9 they give us this run, but it hasn't been successful for them. There you see the second attempt by them to run the ball, and it didn't work. The funny thing about it, or the unusual thing about it also, is that had they planned on kicking the field goal after it, they ran to the short side of the field, which put the kicker all the way on the hash mark. And if you are going to run, at least land the field goal kicker up in the middle.
All right, Doug Morrow, do you have anything to add to that?
Well, just to kind of echo what Bert said, the surprising thing to me was that they've been so successful throwing the ball. On this drive, gosh, they've thrown it very, very quickly. Here you see the ball's getting ready to be marked for play. Florida has their entire offensive line, except for the center, lined up to the left side of the ball, and they have the center and the kicker lined up directly behind it.
A little different line now. They're moving, shifting. Well, they must have learned that in Las Vegas. A kick. He boomed it. Way up in the crowd. It's now 17-7 in favor of Florida over LSU. 48 seconds remaining in the half. We'll be back in a moment.
WJBO Sports includes Coach Jerry Stovall daily.
And Bert Jones, and let's take a look at the halftime stats, gentlemen. We'd have not very impressive running game by the Tigers, and why don't you guys hash them over here?
Well, I tell you, Wayne, you see the rushing game for LSU with only 37 yards, and that statistic in itself, I think, tells you a lot, but really a more telling one is the fact that Dalton Hilliard's had 5 attempts rushing for 8 net yards, Gary James 4 attempts for 17 yards, and James has caught one pass, Hilliard none. And that fact, I think, is really what sets LSU and Florida apart in this game. LSU's great explosive backs have touched the ball a total of only 10 times in the first half. Florida has controlled it almost 17 minutes of possession to LSU's 13, and really Florida's dominated the line of scrimmage. Bert, what do you think about what LSU can do in their passing game to try to get something moving this half?
Well, they're just going to have to put it in the air a little bit more. They've already established, or unfortunately have established, that they are not going to be able to do a whole lot on the ground, and they're just going to have to rely to the air. The only drive they had was really 2 plays, Jeff Rickersham to Eric Martin. They're going to have to rely on it now because Florida is playing their defense to stop the run. And when someone does that, that means they have to play at least 8 men on the line of scrimmage, and consequently, it's shut them down, and it's done that today. So we're going to have to rely on the pass a little bit more downfield, and hope that after we do that, then we can come back and run the ball effectively.
Is that down threesome for Florida just that tough to run on? You know, we noticed before the game started, they had 113 tackles to LSU's 3 down linemen, 33 tackles.
Well, I'm sure they're very tough. Thus far, though, I've been more impressed with Florida's linebackers, their lateral pursuit going
after the ball carriers of LSU has been excellent. They're stopping the plays at the line of scrimmage, some of them behind, and they're getting into the pass coverage as well also.
Now, you both have mentioned getting the ball to Hilliard and James in the open. Now, can you go in there at halftime and say, all right, we haven't used these plays yet. Let's put them in. Let's get the ball to these guys in the open.
Well, they've got plays in their offense to get the ball to them. The problem is Florida, remember we talked about before the game, got hurt last year so badly by those two. I think that they came out and decided, heck, we're going to try to keep the ball out of their hands. In the passing game, they're trying to put people man for man on Hilliard and James. And, of course, like Bert mentioned, their linebackers are so quick. Wilbur Marshall, he can go downfield 15 yards, 20 yards, and he can also pass rush. He's a great athlete, and you can't completely stop him. All you can do is try to neutralize him. And, unfortunately, LSU's not been able to do anything to offset what Florida has done defensively to stop Hilliard and James. And that's, you know, that's the technical thing they've got to try to do, and that's where the strategy comes in.
Should LSU blitz more in the second half?
I don't think so, because I think Florida has a very experienced quarterback in Peace, and the one time that they really came up in blitz, it was 6 points for Florida. He read it. He obviously audible eyes, put one more man in the pattern than LSU had to cover, and it, you know, went into 6 points.
All right, the LSU-Florida game, in addition to nationwide exposure on the USA Network, is also seen on Tiger Vision, LSU's innovative and highly successful pay television service. LSU Tiger fans in Louisiana who cannot buy tickets to the games here can see the games live with this subscription service. And it's hoped that this game will be the first college pay television game in the country to gross in excess of $100,000. We'll also have the LSU-Alabama game on USA Network. And Tennessee, who also appeared on USA Network this year, will be introducing their pay TV service this year. And LSU is one of only two schools in America with all of their football games on television this year. Lorenzo Hampton is back to take the kick of Juan Betanzos. And Hampton has, for a gentleman who has been replaced in that starting lineup at Florida, has made his presence felt in this ball game as a all-round athlete. He's caught four passes, including a touchdown, carried the ball five times. He's returned kicks. So Charlie Pell is getting his money's worth out of Lorenzo Hampton. Only six first downs for the Tigers in the first half, 13 for Florida. And the rushing yardage was just double. LSU, Florida doubled LSU in rushing yardage. So we're ready to go here as we begin the second half. It's a beautiful night for football. A little warm in Baton Rouge. Around 82 degrees, but we took the air. Burt Jones and Doug Morrow offering their expert analysis. Betanzos kicks, and it's a knuckleball coming down short at the 20 and up to the 30-yard line. It's Ricky Natil, who is an excellent player on special teams. He's a headhunter and a good athlete. Last week, he made three tackles. Out of four kickoffs, he made three tackles and helped on another one. Tough. All right. Let's see what Wayne Peace will do with a 17-7 lead. Bromley, the center, pitch back. All right. Anderson is brought down by Rydell Melanson.
Great play by Melanson. Wayne, I think he's the one that there's a flag on the play, and Florida clipped, and I believe the clip was applied to Melanson, the right side linebacker. He came in and made the tackle nonetheless. Although I imagine LSU will have an opportunity to take that big penalty and will take it to try to back Florida a little bit deeper in their own territory.
Peace has been consistent, hitting about 60% of his passes before this game, hit 68% last year, and he's hitting about 66% tonight. That's money in the bank when you're that accurate. Ball is back to the 15. The clip, as you call, was witnessed by the officials. Jimmy Harper is the referee. The umpires, P.T. Williams, Joe Haynes, the lineman, Ronnie Barnes, the line judge, Joe Delaney, the field judge, Ted Thomas, the back judge, and Harold Johnson is the clock operator. First and 25. And this is what Tiger fans are hoping for. Chapman moves up into the line. They're showing the blitz. Burke moves up. He's back. Draw play. Williams gets the call, breaks the tackle, and gets over the 25-yard line. Jeffrey Dale finally brought him down, but Malasaw had a crack at him, but he got by Rydell and made some extra valuable yardage.
He really did. He almost picked up everything that he lost in that penalty there, just on excellent running, good blocking, and just a good draw play.
Second and 13.
Yeah, guy didn't have a bad average last week, did he? Four carries for 104 yards?
That's not bad. You know, ordinarily you say, well, he worked hard all game and picked up 104 yards. He carried it four times. A 70-yard touchdown didn't hurt his average either. All right, Barbe, Kittick, and Osborne, the tackles, and there is Peace running out of the pocket, and Osborne got a hand on him. The big freshman. Good thing he did, too.
It really was. There was a lot of open field here. You see Wayne Peace going back, trying to throw to his right. All the receivers are covered. He says, uh-oh, better get back up in the line of scrimmage. And that little shirt tail. I bet he wishes he has a tearaway jersey.
A shorter shirt tail. And Big Oz got a handle on it. Third and 10 now. Now Hampton takes up position with a flanker on the right side. Single setback and three wideouts. Peace throws. Intercepted. Eugene Daniel, it was thrown right to him, and 13-yard return, and the Tigers have the football in a major break. Was that a high heart when they got away or what?
Here you see Wayne Peace is just trying to throw. It's into double coverage, but the receiver's underneath the second man, and he just overthrew him right to Eugene Daniel, catches it. Turns it upfield, looking for a block, trying to get all the way in for six.
The ball on the 36-yard line of the Gators. 17-7, Florida leading LSU. Strong right formation and an eye. Lang straight ahead. But Roy Harris grabs him as he goes through and wrestles him to the turf. And he had plenty of help, too.
LSU coming right out of the chute with a running play first off. It's the same thing that they did on the first series. They went to the fullback the first series of the game, and here they came with a trap to Lang in the middle. Not too much yardage, but maybe they're trying to get Florida's linebackers to respect the inside. They've got to gain yardage before they'll do it, though.
All right. Hilliard with the ball. Tries to bounce outside, and he's hit. And among those, it was Roger Sibbald, the defensive back, who slowed him down and made him change his direction. The Florida defense, gentlemen, is a penetrating, swarming defense, isn't it?
It really has, and they've virtually shut down this tall sweep of LSU's that has been so successful for them throughout the year. Here you see Dalton showing his excellent balance coming up. Boom. Roy Harris just comes up and knocks him back right off his feet.
Third and four. Hilliard gets the call. Stop. At the 27.
Well, I'll tell you, that shows an awful lot of confidence in your running game. In your game, LSU in the first half had somewhere around 80 yards rushing, and here went on the ground
37
yards rushing, and went on the ground three times in a row with the ball fairly deep in Florida territory.
So now we have a fourth down and about a yard, and they're going to go for the field goal with Batanzos. His longest kick this year is 37 yards, and this is a 44-yard attempt. Mackey holding, Gore centers. The kick is long enough, and it's good. It is 17-10, Florida, 11:08 to go in the third quarter. We'll be back. All right, Hampton is deep. I bet if you put it to a vote of the fans, they'd have said go for the first down, right, Doug Morrow?
I think they will always say go for that. If you put it to the fans, I think they would like to have seen the ball in the air on first, second, and third down, much less that fourth down. But LSU apparently, Wayne, felt like they made enough adjustments in the offensive line where they will be able to run against Florida. I really was surprised they kept it on the ground all three times, but at least they got 3 points out of it, and they're back in the game.
All right, Hampton is deep, a short kickoff. Gathered in on the 13, down on the 20. Well, the Tigers seem to have a little more activity on special teams.
They really do. They're running down the field all fired up, trying to make the play, and they do. It was a very short kick, and they stop them on the 21-yard line, or the 22. The fine coverage by the LSU coverage team there.
Michael Brooks, that freshman linebacker you like, Bert.
Well, he's from my hometown, which has a little bearing on it.
Four plays, 9 yards, a 44-yard field goal. That's not what you'd call a long, sustained drive by LSU. 17-10 score, 11:04 to go in the third quarter. Florida with the lead and the football. Williams. About a yard. Jeffrey Dale made the hit.
You can see just a lot more pursuit on LSU's defense than they had in the first half. That's just effort. That's the type of effort they had last week against Washington, and certainly they'll need to have that in order to try to keep up with Florida's fine running game. Florida's got an injury. Let's see if we can pick up who that is, Wayne.
All right. Good pursuit by the Tigers along the line of scrimmage that time as they shut the door to Williams. He was looking for a hole, and there was just no place to go. So it's 2nd and 9 with 10:48 to go in the third quarter. LSU has scored here early on a 44-yard field goal by Juan Carlos Matanzos. And the ball is now on the 22. Let's see if we can get the identity. Oh, that's Dixon.
Wayne Dixon.
Oh, that would be a tough loss for Florida if he can't come back. Dwayne Dixon is a very talented wide receiver. Oh, you hate to see that, don't you?
You bet. That's a tough one. Anytime you have any player go down, it just
looks
makes
like
this game rough. But it's part of it. It's a contact sport.
Yep. All right, 2nd and 9. We'll see who checks in for Dixon. Probably McDonald. Pitch back to Williams, trying that outside perimeter again, and he's driven out of bounds short of the 30-yard line by Ricky Chapman. See if we can pick up what's happening with Dixon on the far side. He's a key man.
They're looking at his left knee, and for a receiver, that's not a very good injury to have.
He caught 4 passes for 69 yards in the first half. Had 96 coming into the game, so he has 100 career passes. Tigers are showing blitz. They back out of it. Peace hits Williams, and Williams is hit. Jeffrey Dale nailed him that time just as the ball arrived. And the Tiger defense is fired up.
Wayne, that was a great play by the LSU defense also, because they got up in the defensive line of scrimmage like they were all coming. Jeffrey Dale was right in there. Then he backed out at the last second, and he took coverage on Williams in the flat, came out there and nailed him after he caught the ball, forcing Florida to punt.
Criswell to punt, 48-yard average, takes the snap on his 15.
Boom.
Sails one. Jefferson has to chase it way back. He picks it up on the 14. Up the side. Hit. Knocked down at the 29. A cannon shot 59-yard punt and a 16-yard return. It was a little lower trajectory than he would like to have, but a 59-yard boomer, and Jefferson really made lemonade out of a lemon there when he picked that one up and got something back, didn't he?
He really did. He made a fine play, picking the ball up, bringing it back up field for LSU, because they would have been in the hole had he not have done that.
Ball on the 30. Wickersham, draw play, smelled out. Woohoo! What a hit by Tim Newton, the 6-foot, 270-pound nose guard. And those down linemen are tough.
Yeah, they really are. Here you see him. Actually, he almost could have taken the handoff on that play. He was in the backfield 4 yards deep making the play. Had he seen Jeff Wickersham a little earlier, he probably could have just taken the ball. Said, here, I'll go with it this way. With
2nd and 15. Well, when you see a guy 6 feet tall at 270 pounds moving like that, I think he smelled that one. Gambrell is a center. And that's a tough matchup. James gets the call. Not much there. Once again, relying on that running game on a 2nd and 15 on their own 25. And it's Fred McAllister making the tackle. Now now they send in their position defensive changes here.
And Jeff LSU Richardson has a tough play here, third and 12 in his own territory. Makes it real rough on the young quarterback.
LSU is 2 of 8 in third down conversions. Wickersham keeps it and looks and throws, and it's Andrews. The tight end delayed and drifted off the line. Doug Morrow, how do you like that one?
I love it. I think that's terrific. And LSU did what they needed to do. Here you see a fake to James. And then Wickersham takes it to the left. He makes Florida's linebackers run themselves out of the play. Andrews lined up, came across the field, and he was completely uncovered because the flow was going after the direction of the fake. A great play and fine execution.
And Patrick Miller, who's come in for Clark, making the tackle for Florida. Straight ahead. Bounces outside. Well, Lang carrying the ball as they tried to fool him with a little quick hitter, and he picked up about 6 yards. It did fool him a little bit. It's a little different LSU team here in the third quarter, is it not?
It really is. They're playing fired-up ball now, and they just need a good drive, and it looks like they're getting it.
They are using a tight end more tonight than they have. James tries to spin outside. Great power and leg drive, but great determination by the Gators. And it's Wilbur Marshall who stuffed that one, but good.
And I tell you, that's Wilbur Marshall again coming from the backside. Just a few plays ago, Wickersham took advantage of his pursuit when he made the fake on the sweep and kept the ball and threw the pass to Andrews. But Marshall continues to come very flat down the line of scrimmage from the backside. He's got so much speed, the ball carry just doesn't have a chance to get away from him.
James has 6 carries, 21 yards. Hilliard, 7 carries, 15 yards. That shows what they've done to the running game. And Wickersham is caught, throws the ball, and it's incomplete as Andrews was the intended receiver. And Burt Jones, you've been in that position, haven't you?
I have, and I have a feeling Jeff probably wishes he hadn't thrown that ball. It was a good thing that it was a linebacker that was on the other end of it and not a defensive back, because had it been a skilled player, not saying linebackers aren't skilled players.
Yeah, you better watch that, how you talk.
Well, typically linebackers have the hands so taped up that they really don't have the feeling, can't catch the ball.
Fourth down. Parker standing on his 42. Punt. It's going to bounce inside the 15, and it's down on about the 14-yard line by Henry Thomas, a 30-yard punt. And that's just about what Parker wanted to do. He'd like to have another 5 or 10 yards on it, but no, the Gators have the football, first and 10 on their 14. They lead 17-10. They've led all the way. We have 6:29 to go in the third quarter in a good football game in the Bayou Land here in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Wayne Peace, one of the best, has an eye formation. Testing that perimeter. And Rydell Melancon makes the tackle.
LSU's getting much better standoffs at the line of scrimmage than they were in the first half. They're not being blown open for those long first down gains like Florida made in that initial drive, and that puts a little extra pressure on Peace in the passing game.
Melancon moves way out now to help Daniels. Now he moves up, try to make the hit. Daniels has to make it, along with Lewis. Now, why was Melancon out there? Was he playing a little bump or what?
Well, he's out there trying to hold up the man who's coming off the line of scrimmage, but he's got responsibility on the run. You're gonna see coming in the picture, and the swift receiver is coming in to crack back. Now, that if he made contact, that's a clip. And it looked like he made contact. The official did not throw a flag, though, and it's a big first down for Florida.
Hampton gets the carry, first and 10 now on the 25-yard line for the Gators. Good hard running, low to the turf. It is Hampton again, and it's Melancon on the tackle. He has a low center of gravity. He and Williams both, John L. Williams, they run
head down, tail up. Hard to stop. Second and five. 5:10 to go in the third quarter. 7-point lead to Florida. They've had a lead all the way. Lang is at the top of your screen. And let's see who we have in as the other wide receiver. Dixon is out with an injury. Hampton gets the call. Bounces right through a hole, and there he goes. Daniels horse collars him at the 20. A 50-yard run by Hampton, and Daniel finally brought him down.
Here you see just a pitch to the right side. Jeffrey Dale was lined up inside of the tight end, was not able to keep a seal because he overran the play in his enthusiasm. Hampton cut back against the grain, found the seal, found the seam. Eugene Daniel ran him down from behind, and Hampton then almost got away.
Lorenzo Hampton has been a fly in the ointment for the Tigers tonight. First and 10 now on the 20. Wayne Pease gives the ball to Anderson, and he spins hard down to the 10-yard line. A good run by Neil Anderson, and Jeffrey Dale finally has to stop him. These twisting, turning, hurtling runners are hard to stop. First down on the 9.
They really are, and Charlie Pell obviously has studied his charts, knowing that if he runs the ball more than the opponent does, he's going to win. As you see this running back coming to the outside. Well, a good cut. Jeffrey Dale's the only man left to make the tackle.
Anderson has 10 carries, 61 yards, 6 yards a pop. Isn't bad. First down on the 9 for the Gators. They lead by 7. McDonald in motion. Anderson gets the call again, and he's rolled down at about the 6-yard line. John Fritchie makes the hit. 11 carries, 64 yards. Hampton has 9 carries for 83 yards. So when Charlie Pell says if we run the football and outgain the other team, we win, that is exactly what's happening thus far tonight. Second and goal from the 7. Lang in motion. Hampton runs hard to the 3, maybe the 2. Eugene Daniel, Roland Barbe.
You know, men, when you watch Hampton run, he's so quick, he looks like a scat back. But he certainly isn't. He's a big running back, and he's got a lot of strength, and you saw it that time. It's 210 pounds. And when he turns it up at the line of scrimmage, he carries people with him. But he's so quick when he gets through that line of scrimmage, he looks like one of those 5'6", 175-pounders.
They like to run behind Lomas Brown, the quick tackle. There is 6'4", 277. We have a timeout call for with a 3rd and 2 on the 2. We'll be back in a moment. Williams has 32 yards rushing. Anderson has 64. Hampton has 88. They've got a 3rd and goal on the 2. They've called a timeout. What are they talking about?
It's a tough call for Charlie Fell here. I feel like they've had success running the ball, and I think he's probably going to do the same.
Going to go outside with it.
And probably to the left side.
Everybody's jammed in tight. Looking for him to come up the middle. That's where they go. The official has the signal, but a lot of other folks have. A yard to go. 4th down. Charlie Pell leads by 7 with 2:40 to go in the 3rd quarter. The ball is on the 1-foot line. They're going to go for it. As the coach says, I have confidence in my offense. Everybody dig in. Touchdown. Well, it's an old play. Over the top, follow your best tackle, Lomas Brown. John Hunt, the guard.
Well, you see it, they weren't trying to disguise it anyway. Both their backs were slanted that way, they were leaning that way, and they ran that way, and they got the touchdown.
Williams scores from the 1 foot line, and Raymond will try the point after. Once again, they go into that shift.
And it's good. So with 2:17 to go in the third quarter, it's 24-10 Florida.
All right, Florida has not, I don't think they've had a passing yard in the half thus far. They have done it on the ground.
And they've done it very well on the ground. They just marched it right down the field on LSU there. You see 9 plays, 86 yards, 4 minutes and 12 seconds. That's a long time to hold the ball.
Pease was 14 of 20 at halftime. He's 14 of 20, 15 of 22, but for no yards, so no additional yards, so they have run it all the way. And the kickoff is down in the end zone by James, and the Tigers will put the ball in play on the 20. All right, now LSU with a 24-10 deficit. 2:17 to go in the third quarter, and the Gators tough to run on. So what do you do?
Well, they're going to have to throw the ball, I feel like, now. They're running out of time. They haven't established much on the ground, and they're going to have to put it in the air.
Wickersham is 9 of 17 for 132 yards. Puts Fontenot in motion. And it's Hilliard with the call and the ball up to the 29. Mark Corp, junior linebacker, junior college transfer, excellent player.
Wayne, you know, that didn't look like much here. Just a simple little hook pattern to the back. Hilliard came out through the line of scrimmage, just hooked up in the defensive secondary between the linebackers, but a big gain for 8 yards.
Hilliard tries to break it outside, and he's knocked down again, but he may have the first down, and he does. Greg Cleveland, left tackle, makes the tackle. This is about as tough a club to run on as I've seen for a while.
I tell you that Tim Newton is as tough a team to run on as you'll see. That guy is big and quick and has made some great plays.
That whole line, Roy Harris, number 99, Tim Newton, number 56, Greg Cleveland, number 64. They're a triumvirate of tough. Wickersham drops. Martin pulled it right out of nowhere. Oh, boy. What was Roy Harris doing back there on pass defense?
Well, what they were trying to do is they were just trying to clear the zone out with Dalton Hilliard coming in, Eric Martin coming underneath behind him. But it really didn't fool anyone, and Eric Martin made a fine play coming up for the catch there.
3-yard pickup, and one of the Gators is shaken up on the play, and it appears to be Curtis Stacy, a defensive back. Yeah, Martin converted an incompletion there for sure into a 3-yard pickup. Just excellent. Hands. What do you see, Bert?
Well, I see. Looks like a pretty good situation. They picked up 8 yards on that last play.
Oh, yeah.
That's gave good. Them a pretty good position to be a 2nd and 3, 2nd and 2.
Scoreboard says 2nd and 7. I wonder why that.
The scoreboard's never right, but unfortunately they are tonight with the score 24-10.
2nd and 7. Lang and Hilliard in the backfield. Junius Doral in motion. Lang gets the call straight ahead. Blowout job over the 45. That time the offensive line sort of took charge for a change. Tim Newton, however, made the touch.
That's really the most dominating play that LSU's offensive line has had this game. It's so difficult to go run against Florida. They've got that big defensive line, and if you try to run laterally, they've got Wilbur Marshall, who, if you run at him, is strong enough to stop your lead blockers. If you run away, he's fast enough to catch you from behind. I guess that's why they're a pretty good team, don't you think?
I guess so. They're an impressive ball club. There's a draw to Lane. That one, I think, fooled Florida. McAllister made the tackle. 9-yard pickup.
It really did. LSU's been successful this half strictly with the pass, and pretty much the first half they felt like that, hey, we've already shut down the pass or already shut down the run, so they got to throw it. So they were all sitting back, as you see Gene Lang just coming up with a good draw play for 9 yards.
And we're reaching the end of the third quarter, and we probably won't get a playoff, and they don't. So that's the end of the third quarter with a score, Florida 24, LSU 10. We'll be back in a moment. All right, the final quarter ready to reveal itself to the fans here. 78,616 in Tiger Stadium. Wayne Mack along with Burt Jones and Doug Morrow, two great Tiger players of their era. And the fourth quarter with the Tigers with the football with a second and one. Wide outs are at the bottom of your screen, and now there goes Fontenot in motion topside. Hilliard. Good leg drive on that one, huh?
It really was. Florida did an unusual thing there. They took out Marshall, who I think is probably their best defensive player in a second and short situation.
In Florida's last 22 games, they've won 20, lost one, and tied one, where they've outrushed an opponent. Tonight, they have rushed for 186 yards thus far, and LSU for 72. First and 10, Hilliard with an impressive shot there. Gets the call again, and he runs into a bunch of folks, including Gambrell and including Marshall, I believe. Who was that?
That's Curtis Stacy's back in
Stacy,
the game. He was taken out two or three plays ago, shaken up, but he wasn't too shaken up that time.
No.
Again, that's the play, though. Jeff Wickersham tried to take advantage of Wilbur Marshall's quickness. The last time he did the thing, Marshall stayed at home, made the tackle in the backfield, or forced him to throw the ball early. That time, Marshall was fooled a little bit, but Stacy came up and made a great play.
Ball on the 37-yard line of the Gators, second and nine. Hilliard in motion. Wickersham has time. Steps up in the pocket, and a little misconnection there as Hilliard was in the vicinity, but he overthrew him. Roy Harris and Wickersham exchanging pleasantries, as gentlemen should. Harris was in the backfield with him and thought he'd introduce himself. Third and nine now. That one didn't work too well, did it, Jim?
I'll tell you, that's tough on a quarterback because Hilliard set up. He was covered, and he didn't move after that. Wickersham was looking for him to throw to him.
Third and nine. There's a blue darter, and it's caught by Andrews. Randy Clark makes the hit. It's a 20-yard pickup, and Andrews is in the offense tonight.
He really is. What they did there was they double coverage both outside receivers, which means Mitch Andrews is one-on-one with a linebacker, and he found the hole, and Jeff Wickersham read the coverage correctly, threw the ball to him, and 20-yard gain for LSU.
First and 10 on the 16-yard line of Florida. 13:25 remaining in the ball game. Big third down conversion. Hilliard gets the call. Lang throws the block, but there are too many folks there for him to take out. The Tigers are now 3 out of 10, 4 out of 11 in third down conversions. Stacy makes the hit. That time it seems that when the Tigers have the lead blocker out there, the fullback, it just seems there are too many Gators there for him to take on.
Well, Florida's been so tough to run against, but this half, you'll notice, Wayne, LSU is getting down the field on that sweep. They picked up 4 yards that time, even though Florida had a lot of people there.
All right. Durrell in motion. Straight ahead. Lang gets inside the 10 to about the 8-yard line. Chewing up some turf.
Well, Wayne, here's a call that all coaches either love or hate, because all week they figure out what they're going to do on third and three on the 10-yard line. And here it is, because it always seems to be the biggest play of the game, because it either means you go in and score or you don't. Let's see what they do on third here.
Martin to the left. Fontenot to the left in the slot. In motion now. Martin is a key man. Hilliard gets the call, and he's smothered behind the line. Gets no chance. to hit the line of scrimmage as Tim Newton, Mr. Tough, in there in that nose guard spot, just took him on. Put a bear hug on him. Now, why is Newton getting free like that in the Tiger backfield? You double team
him
or what?
You see, just the guard didn't make the cutoff block on him here, and he's able to get right in there, make the play. Fourth down, brings up fourth down here. And the way I see it, LSU has no choice but to go after it. They're trailing by two touchdowns.
Fourth and two. Do you throw it here? They're so tough to run on. Gravy's $5 a sop when you try to run on Florida, and they don't get it. That play did not develop. He had to hurdle Lang, who was thrown out of the play. And the Tigers eschew the pass. And did not get it. So a great stand by the Gators. And the Tigers attacked them where they're the toughest. Florida takes over on their 8-yard line now with a first and 10 with 11:18 to go in the ball game.
You're right, Wayne. LSU had some success running so far this half, but has had much more success throwing the ball. That time, Florida just stacked it up right inside of their 10-yard line and took the ball over.
Play just did not develop, and now Peace takes charge. Well, a little loose tackling up front, and Anderson gets free out to about the 14 before Eugene Daniel brings him down. Once again, now like a bowling ball, they hit that line of scrimmage and break a tackle and skirt to the outside.
Here you see just a series of missed tackles right there. Had it not been for Eugene Daniel, he would have still been running down the sideline.
Yeah, he might have been out in the parking lot by now. Second and four. Have to put your shoulder in on those tackles. Anderson doesn't go down when you wave at him. And he gets the call again. Cuts inside a block, and Chapman wraps him up there. Ricky Chapman. Oh, let's see what we have here. 13 carries, 76 yards for Anderson. 10 carries, 88 yards for Hampton. 9 carries, 34 yards for Williams.
Florida very content to stay on the ground. They're picking up good yardage and eating up the clock. And with that two-touchdown advantage, they really have LSU in a tough position.
This time they give the ball to the fullback. And Sean Burks puts a stop on Joe Henderson, sophomore from Winter Garden, Florida. Well, like you say, they have 9 minutes and 50 seconds to go now. They can use some time. Second down, 8 yards to go. They're on their own 22. And Peace has not had to throw the ball a lot tonight. He is still 15 of 22 for 185 yards. He hasn't thrown for a yard this half. Anderson gets the call this time. There's no place to go. Alex Clark stuffed that one.
Let's give a lot of credit to Jeffrey Dale over there, too, because he came. Actually, Florida had a pretty good steal initially, and then Jeffrey Dale came up from the safety position and just submarined the interference, knocked them all down. You see right there, and that stacked up Williams in front of the ball carrier, allowing Clark to come up and make the tackle.
Three Florida players who played in this game last year, James Jones, Bob Huckel, and Tyrone Young, are in the pros now in the NFL. 3rd and 8. A draw play gets nothing, and once again they stay on the ground, and Ricky Chapman plugged the gap. Well, if fortune should determine that Florida loses this game, is the fans would say you should have opened it up a little bit, Charlie.
Well, that may be true. They're showing that they've had good success running the ball, but it also looks like they might have a tendency to say, I don't want to lose this game by throwing the ball. They're just trying to run the clock out.
Oh, a line drive punt. Jefferson takes it on the 33. And he gets up close to the 40, and that's it. 46-yard line drive punt and a 7-yard return. That
Patrick Miller down there to make the tackle. Jefferson was looking for some little crease, but didn't develop. To go. The Tigers need to strike. And they'll have to do it over the top because it's almost impossible to run on this Florida team. Wickersham takes to the air. Throws one out the front. No at the 50. 10-yard pickup.
A 10-yard burn looks like it comes a lot easier that way than the other way. It certainly has come a lot easier tonight via the air than it has to run. And with 8 minutes left, they got to do a lot of it.
Clock is ticking away inside of 8 minutes. Wickersham is 13 of 22 for 177 yards, one interception. 24 to 10, Florida leading. It's their second SEC game, LSU's first conference game.
A great catch by Gary James at the 35. 16 yards. You like that pass, Bert Jones, huh?
Well, I like the catch more than I like the pass. It was an excellent thrown ball, but here you see Gary James right in the middle of a lot of traffic, jumping up for the ball, making himself tall. Makes the play, makes the catch, and another first down.
And Fred McAllister was defending and made him pay a little price for that one. 7:25 to go. Ball on the 34-yard line, first and 10. Fontenot in motion. Strong right formation. Draw play. Lang gets the call, gets the ball, and he's inside the 30. Picked up of about six. And it was Wilbur Marshall. He has a broken hand, but I think they'd have to break both of them before they could slow him down.
I don't know if that would slow him down. He probably broke it on purpose just to make it a little bit more even.
He's a fine football player. Last year, LSU devised their whole offensive scheme just to try and get around him. Second and four. Lang again, this time inside the 25, but this takes time. 6:33 to go.
Close to a first down, and they desperately need another one.
McAllister makes the hit. Newton helps plug the gap. And let's see here for LSU. Lang has 10 carries, 39 yards. James, 6 carries for 21 yards. Hilliard, 12 carries, 31 yards. Not much there. Not much room. 6 minutes remaining. Third and one. Sneak by Wickersham gets the first down. 6:32:05. Good leg drive. Off the right shoulder of Mike Gambrell, the center.
Wayne, you know that clock, though, continues to roll. It stopped here for the first down, but as soon as the chains are set, it's going to start again. LSU's eating up an awful lot of time on this drive. There's just under 6 minutes left in the game, but they've got to score, kick off, get the ball back, and score again, assuming they're able to do all that, just to get back where they can go ahead or even tie.
All right. Wideouts are left and right. The backs are split. This is a passing formation. He wants to do it, and he's going to. And a blitz is on, and he rolls out of the pocket wide open.
James, a magnificent cut, and he's knocked down after 21-yard pickup.
What a dance he put on, huh?
Both he and Jeff Wickersham put on a dance here. A blitz coming. Jeff reads it. He says, uh-oh, not enough men for me to get them all. So he runs out to the outside, throws it to Gary James, and watch him do his thing. Fakes one man out, breaks the tackle, breaks another tackle, and down to the one-yard line.
He left Bruce Vaughn grabbing for air. The ball is on the two. James gets the call and is knocked down. There's a flag thrown in the end zone. Ten yards back of the line of scrimmage, a flag was thrown. What does that indicate? Holding?
Typically
on the part of the defense?
No, either the part of the defense or the part of the offense, but this time they say
a procedure against the defense. Now what is it? What could that be? Illegal procedure against the defense. Too many men on the field?
I think that's what they're calling it right now.
That's what Randy Hayden says. He's our statistician and vice president in charge of pacing up and down here at the booth.
And that's what they had against Southern Cal earlier this year that cost him the ball game.
How about that? Well, the last play, huh?
The guy still thinks he's supposed to be in there, doesn't he?
First down now on about the 1 foot line. Sneak. Touchdown. 5 minutes and 4 seconds to go. There is a flag, is there?
There's a flag right on the goal line, which would indicate offsides on either one or the other.
Offside Florida, and I'm sure LSU will decline that one.
All right. It's 24 for the Gators and 16 for the Tigers. And the important conversion coming up.
Do you go for two right here? Do you run a fake kick and try to get your 2 points right here?
No.
Okay. I guess you got to do it next time then, huh?
Yep. Matanzos. Mackey holds. Gore snaps. The ball is down. The kick is up.
It's 24-17 with 5:04 to go here in Baton Rouge. The Gators lead the Tigers by 7. All right, the Florida defense has allowed less than 12 points a game going into this one. It's now 24-17. They lead the Tigers. Are ready for the kickoff. Are we going to see one of those wedge shot kickoffs or what?
I imagine we'll see the sky kick here, although with Florida up on the ball, the Tigers may kick it deep.
Eric Ender and Hampton are deep. There's a kick is gathered in on the 15. Fine play. Well, Jackie Sherrill is trying the 12th man on special teams down in Texas A&M.
Got Toby Kasten down on the field. He was the first man down on the kickoff and made a dive for the kick returner and somehow has injured himself. It does not appear to be a leg injury, but whatever it is, he's not real happy with it.
It looks like he just went out, reached out with his arm and tripped him, and it looks to me like it's either his right shoulder or right arm.
Fine prospect, Toby Kasten. Well, we were going to mention Sherrill is using the 12th man over there at A&M. Hadn't been too successful here in Tiger Town. The 12th man is the crowd. Kasten trucks off, and that's good. And they're hoping here that they can influence the Gators, but the Gators ball club is solid and veteran and tough. Hear that crowd? That's what they want to do.
This right here, all it was a double coverage on the outside receiver. He was trying to hit him into the hole of the zone, and he come up with a big interception.
Bert, you know, it looked like he went back there and thought that his receiver was by the man, started to throw at him, and pulled up when he saw the second man come over. Whatever it was a perfect interception.
78,000 fans, and what a noise. Wickersham to the air. It's Andrews again for 20 yards.
Here we see it, Jeff Wickersham dropping back, play action fake, looking for a tight end over the middle, and finds it. It's a fine catch by Mitch Andrews coming up and makes it a big play for LSU.
McAllister hit him as the ball arrived, but he hung on. Lang. 4 yard. Wow, what a game, fans. 4:20 to go. 24-17, Florida. LSU after the interception by Clark. A strike to Andrews, who has 4 catches for 78 yards tonight. He had 5 for the season going into the game. peels off to the right. Strong right. Fontenot. Top of your screen. Martin to the bottom.
Here comes the blitz.
Motion by Hilliard. Uh-oh. They're going to get him for a motion. He was going straight ahead when the ball was snapped, I believe, right?
Yeah, it looked like he changed the play at the line of scrimmage, and then he sent the tailback in motion. The clock was right at the end. I don't know if the officials called the clock for running to zero or if the ball was snapped right there while the tailback was still going forward. Either way, it's 5 yards against LSU.
Procedure called. Bad break for the Tigers. Good break for the Gators. Second and 14 now. 3:46 to go in the football game. 24-17 Gators. What a game in Tiger Town. Junius Doral to the top of the screen. Martin to the bottom. Jeff Wickersham. The pressure's on. Incomplete. Well, it's now third and 14. Burt Jones, Doug Morrow, give us a little consultation here. Now you have 30 seconds to tell us what to do.
Well, that's when the coach always looks at the quarterback and says, well, I've got you this far. You give me the rest of the way. Third and 14 is a tough one, but it's also the biggest play of the game for LSU at this stage. They're going to have to put the ball in the air. And if that were me, I think I would throw it to my best hand. It looks like tonight it's Eric Martin and Mitch Andrews.
Eric Martin is a clutch player. He's to the bottom of the screen. Fontenot to the top. They're both good targets. 6'1", 205. Good hands. It's a wing right with a single setback, and Wickersham drops. It's caught by Martin inside the 10. But not enough. It's going to be fourth. 11-yard pickup, fourth and three, and Bruce Vaughn brought Martin down before he could get to that first down marker. Well, you called it. That slant is a big play. Fourth and three. Now, when the Tigers have had this before, they've run the football. What are you going to do now, Doug Morrow?
Well, last time when they had this and they ran the football, they came up with nothing. And I think that they're not going to let that happen again. I would expect that they're going to try to get in the air short, either to Andrews or to Hilliard.
All right. Andrews is a strong left this time, and Junius Doral is in motion. Single back. Caught! Doral at the three. Vaughn, the tackle. 36 to go in the game.
A clutch play by both Jeff Wickersham and Doral.
That was a fine catch. Anytime you've got to come across the middle, that quarterback's got to be perfect with the throw, and the receiver's really got to concentrate on the catch.
And both were there on that one.
That may be Doral's first catch of the year. Oh, knocked down, Hilliard. Wow, running inside on the Gators. That's like winning against live Gators, real Gators. Alonzo Johnson, number 93, 6'3", 215, and tough, makes the hit. Second down and two. Second and goal from the two. 2 minutes to go. 24-17, Florida. In comes number 82, Junius Doral with a play. Tough test for a sophomore. Wickersham behind Gambrell puts his man in motion. Hilliard caught behind the line again. And it's Alonzo Johnson who will not be contained. What a player. Wilbur Marshall gets a lot of attention, but Alonzo Johnson gets a lot of tackles. Minute and 21. 118, third and goal from the five.
And LSU's got three timeouts left. They're not taking it now, though. They're sending in a play by Fontenot, and I would expect, Wayne, don't you think, that they're going to throw the ball here after losing yardage on two runs?
I would think that's highly likely. Takes a draw. Intercepted. Is it Marshall? Wilbur Marshall with the interception. It was play action, and Marshall was there, and the Tigers are stopped knocking at the door with 46 seconds to go in the football game. What a play by Wilbur Marshall.
I'm not so sure it was just a great play or Jeff just didn't see him. Tough play. Jeff comes up, tries to make the tackle, but it's one of those things that will haunt him.
Well, what I like about it is he made the interception with that broken hand.
He jumped
you
up
said
like
something derogatory a while ago about linebackers' ability to as receivers, I think.
I guess I should have never said that.
I think that was you. 24-17, 46 seconds to go. And Anderson gets a pitch back, and away he goes. Oh, brother! All the way! 76 yards! Well, what a swing around in a football game. The Tigers knocking on the door at the two-yard line to tie it or go ahead. And in the next play, the Gators seal the victory. It seemed as if the Tigers were caught in a time warp and couldn't move.
Well, that's just great running and great blocking by Florida's offensive line. LSU, it looked like, was having a difficult time recovering from the shock of the interception. And here Florida just came out, a quick pitch to Neil Anderson around the left side. Wasn't touched and outran LSU's entire defensive team.
15 carries, 151 yards for Anderson. Raymond will try the conversion. Wow, the Gators are pumped up down there tonight. Let me look here. I think the record will show that Florida did not pass for a yard in the second half of this football game.
Two passes, I believe, and two interceptions. That was it in the second half, wasn't it?
Did not pass for a yard. Amazing when you have a passer like Peace. Now they're shifting again. I don't know why they're doing this. Looks like an old Betty Grable movie.
I think they do that because if the LSU defensive line doesn't shift with them.
All right, the kick is good anyhow after the Terpsichorean endeavor by the Gators. It's 31-17. We'll be back in a moment. All right, the door has been shut in the face of the Tigers of LSU as they had a first down on the two-yard line of Florida. They tried to run the football and could not. They tried to pass the football, and they could not pass. And Perkins kicks off. And James gathers it in on the one. And is knocked down as he crosses the 20, and with 28 seconds remaining, it'll be a tough loss for the Tigers and a really great victory for Florida because they did it in an unusual way. When you have such a passer as they have and an offense that they have, and you don't pass for a single yard in the second half. Total offense, 456 for Florida and 353 thus far for LSU. Big plays have been big in this ballgame. 58-yard touchdown, 76-yard touchdown. Lang takes the pass and is knocked down immediately. And the clock is ticking inexorably toward the end of this football game. The fans were certainly stunned by that interception. And the Tigers made a valiant effort, but they met an opponent tonight that absolutely would not be denied. As last year, the Tigers went to Florida and stopped the Gator Express, and tonight, Florida comes into Tiger Town, and they have put it on LSU with a very convincing defensive effort and some great running. Next week, the Tigers go to Tennessee. This game has been on USA Network tonight, and we're happy for that. Last year we were on the USA Network with Florida and LSU. And we will have the Alabama LSU game on USA Network. Burke Jones, Doug Morrow, and yours truly, Wayne Mack. And we hope you've enjoyed our story of the ball game. It's been an excellent football game. Wickersham wrestled to the turf as he gets one off, but it's all academic and cosmetic as we have 6 seconds remaining. And
Patrick Miller makes a defensive play on the far side for the Gators. The clock stops when the play moved out of bounds, and this, unless something happens, should be the last play of the game. Jeff Wickersham, 20 of 31 for 252 yards, two interceptions. The first one didn't hurt anything. It was at the half when he tried a bomb. But the last one was a bone crusher. And a heart stopper. And that ought to do it. The clock shows 0-0, and the Gators of Florida have defeated the Tigers of LSU by a score of 31-17 here in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. It was too much running game. Charlie Pell, in his last 22 games, when his team has outrushed the opponents, has won 20, lost one, and tied one. And tonight, they outrushed LSU and did it handily. As a matter of fact, Anderson gained 151 yards rushing, and that exceeded the entire rushing effort of the LSU team by far, as they had only 37 yards at halftime. And Hilliard, in 14 carries, had 30 yards. Lang, in 11 carries, had 40 yards. And James, in 6 carries, had 21 yards. That stacks up to 91 yards for the three leading ball carriers for the Tigers. So that tells the story. All right, fans, we'll return here for some closing comments from Burt Jones and from Doug Morrow. We'll return with closing comments following this commercial break.
Well, fans, a tough loss for the Tigers. I've never seen an easy loss. And one thing I like about my two friends here, Burt Jones and Doug Morrow, they both played offense, and yet I can turn to them for an analysis on the game, and they can cover different areas and not duplicate each other's comments. So first, let me turn to Doug. Doug, give me your comment.
Well, a strange game, because I thought that LSU in the second half, after they had fought and scratched and clawed, really got in a position where they started to control the game. Florida did not have much confidence at the beginning of the second half in their offense, and LSU moved the ball pretty well, and then as the game went on, looked like they started to control it, and then they went down there and didn't score that time, and then got it back and scored the next time anyway, then got it back and went down again, and bam, in two plays, they give up the ball, and they give up a touchdown. So the game really blew open the last few plays, but I thought that LSU had an excellent chance to win it.
Bert? I feel like LSU probably should have won it, and I feel like LSU probably feels the same way. It was one of those unfortunate deals. Wayne Pease made the first mistake by throwing the interception to LSU. LSU came back, drove it down, got into position to score, and then on the tough play, Jeff Wickersham threw it to the wrong person. He threw it to the defensive linebacker, and he ran it up, and then the next play they went down for the score is right. It was one of these games that LSU really didn't do well rushing the ball offensively. And Florida did. And that really was the story of the game. They were able to move the ball on the ground, and we weren't.
As evidenced by the final touchdown when Anderson galloped 76 yards. So with their final effort of the ball game, the Gators were once again in charge. Well, we hope you've enjoyed the story of the ball game. We've done our best to keep you abreast of what's been happening. I want to thank Doug Morrow and Burt Jones for their expert analysis. And we'll be with you next week for the LSU-Tennessee game. So thank you, and from Tiger Town, good evening.
Well, you get down the fiddle and you get down the bow. Kick off your shoes and you throw them on the floor. Dance in the kitchen till the morning light. Louisiana Saturday night. Waiting in the front yard, sitting on a log. A single-shot rifle and a one-eyed dog. Yonder come our kinfolk in the moonlight, Louisiana Saturday night. Well, you get down the fiddle and you get down the bow. Kick off your shoes and you throw them in the floor. Dance in the kitchen till the morning light, Louisiana Saturday night. Jack, belly full of beer and a possum in a sack. 15 kids in the front porch light, Louisiana Saturday night. When the kinfolk leave and the kids get fed, me and my woman gonna slip off to bed. Have a little fun when we turn out the lights, Louisiana Saturday night.